Hi, this is Dr. Will Whedon, and we're here today just to bless you and to share this beautiful day with you by way of video. We're in California, and I just believe that your day is as beautiful where you are as this day that we're enjoying here in Southern California. It's my belief that you are really being impacted today by the immediacy of God's presence in your consciousness, and that you are very aware that you are one with your Father, and there's no difference between you. We've been at our church. We've been dealing with the duality of belief systems in the world. There's this duality that we lose once we come into the immediacy of God's presence, and we're aware of that. Duality goes completely out of the window. God is so secure that He's gifted Himself to you. There's a place in John chapter 20 where Jesus comes in a locked room where his disciples are gathered. And in that locked room, He breathes on them. First of all, He tells them peace, and He gives them peace, and His salutation is peace. Then later on in this discussion He's having with them, He breathes on them. And this is symbolic of what they know about their Bible, Genesis, and our Old Testament, Genesis, where there's an illustration, there is an allegory, a story that talks about how God breathed in the nostrils of Adam, and Adam became a living soul or a living being. Well, in that same manner, He breathed on them, told them to receive the Holy Spirit. So He's sharing His life source with His apostles and disciples. And what He's saying is, I'm giving you what's mine, and I want you to take what's mine as yours, as a gift. It's not meritorious. There's no merit that causes you to be a receptacle of this gift. It is bestowed on you because of love. And He goes on to tell them about the belief and the thought of sin. I call sin error. And He says, whatever sins you forgive, and whatever errors you forgive, they are forgiven. And whatever errors or sins you retain, you're stuck with them, because my work is finished, where all sins and errors have been removed from mankind, and there's nothing standing in the way between man and God. Now, if someone offends you and you allow that error to stand between you and your brother, then you're stuck with that. It's not a God thing, it's a brother thing, where you need to go to Him and share with Him how you've been offended. Pray for one another so this offense will no longer separate you from your brother. Do not live in a life of duality. Live a life of oneness, as God is living a life of oneness with you. No pluralities, no dualities, just one. Sameness or likeness. And so that revelation is very important. We also have been discussing in our church the Western view of Christ and the Near Eastern view of Christ. In the Western view of Christ, we see Him called Soteriology. And Soteriology has to do with, we view Him as Savior. And this has so many different explanations behind it. We think as Savior, He's like us, but He's other than we are. He's not fallen like we are. Well, He's not, but He's not other either. And so the Near Eastern view is to view Him as wisdom and Sophiology. And in that teaching, it talks about how He is the wisdom. He's been made wisdom unto us to teach us how to navigate the course of life that we're living in. Now, there's no real explanation for salvation in the Near Eastern view. It is, though, the explanation of sharing your life, being a life giver. And in Scripture, He says He is the life-giving Spirit. The first Adam was a living soul. The last Adam, which Christ is a life-giving Spirit. So He's here to give your life and your spirit, give life to you and your spirit. That's how He draws you from darkness into His light, by giving you light. Paul writes about this in his revelation, his thought on this, that the law of life has swallowed the law of sin and death. So it's not so much as a fight, it's just a greater taking advantage and just taking in that which is weaker and making that which is weaker its strength. It doesn't ward it off as though it's different. It embraces it and makes it one as it is. So when we don't fight fearfully We don't reject evil. We embrace it with life. We swallow it up, and evil absolutely disappears. Now, the contrast or the comparison with evil is that it's dark, and that righteousness of God is light. So light always dispels darkness. It doesn't war against it. You just flick the light on and darkness disappears. Actually, light swallows up the darkness. You turn off the light and darkness is present, is there. So what we, in that contrast, in that comparison, we understand, as long as we walk in the consciousness of the immediacy of the presence of God in our life, we are the lights in the world. We are lights to ourselves and to all of that we influence around us, and darkness flees. And in the light, you find the wholeness and completeness, the health, the soundness, the wisdom of God. So make sure you allow your light to shine. And so that's what we're trying to encourage our believers. Don't be warring against evil. Jesus says, don't war against evil. Just be yourself. Accept the light and life of God in you. And anything that is not light or life will flee. It'll leave. Ignore it. Don't give it no place. Don't empower it by giving it attention or resistance or battling against it or warring against it, because all you do is empower it. Just simply don't acknowledge it, and it will flee from you. That's wisdom of God. That's how you navigate through this life wisely. You also begin to attract what you are. Light attracts even more light. Life attracts even more life. Because you're thinking, and your thinking is your creative machine that's happening on this plane. It's as a man thinks, so is he. So you want to order your thoughts. You want to cast down any imaginations that exalt itself against the knowledge of Christ that's inside of you, and bring those imaginations to obedience to the thought life of Christ that's in you. You want to make sure that the power that's in you is expressed through you, because you're conscious of the immediacy of the presence of God, which makes you conscious of his power that is dwelling inside of you. And the kingdom that is in you is greater than the kingdom of your flesh, for the gates of hell shall not prevail against the kingdom of God that's inside of you. We're going to stop there. I think that gives you a little bit to think on today. And remember that God has plans for your life, and none of those plans include defeat. Until next time.